Today I wanted to talk about something aside from business, and that's how I purchased 2 properties before I was 30. Hey everyone, I'm so appreciative of you being here. Every video I've published recently has a few hundred views. So yeah, it just means a lot to me that what I'm filming and what I'm sharing with the world is going to somebody's ears, and hopefully you're taking some sort of something, advice, tips, anything away from these videos. If you're new here, I'm Lisa and I'm an edtech entrepreneur who's obsessed with self-improvement. So on this channel, I wanted to share with you a real authentic look into my life behind the scenes of trying to grow a business, but also the things that I learn along the way, including all the self-improvement books that I read, which is a heck of a lot. Basically in this video, I'll cover 8 things that I think are important if you are somebody who's starting your property journey, or even if you're just thinking about it. Here are some tips that I've learned along the way that I hope to share with you, and hopefully you can benefit from it. I also wanted to add in that I'm absolutely not an expert, and I think a part of this whole property journey, or if you're going on any sort of investment journey, is that there's a lot of doubt and uncertainty, but I'll talk about how you can remedy those feelings as you progress in this journey. So the first thing I will say is that understand that everybody has different strategies. You know, once you start diving into the property scene, you'll come across so many different people who are like, I've been really successful here, I've bought 6 properties here, or I've bought 150 properties in 3 years, things like that, and you're just like, what the heck? And every single person will have their own unique strategy. It took me a really long time to understand this. Sort of came into it thinking that there was just sort of one way of going about it, but that is completely not true. And then if we look at it from an even bigger lens, you'll see that when you start talking to people about property, others will sort of try to take you along the shares journey or the bonds journey. And everybody has different ways of investing, even cryptocurrency, for example. I think when you start off, like me, it's really good to start doing your research and then find the type of investment or investments that resonate with you. So I had looked into shares for a while. I'd looked into bonds, I'd looked into cryptocurrency even, but at the end of the day, I sort of found that property was the one that spoke to me the most. One, my family is sort of all into property, so I grew up with hearing talk about property, so I was more familiar with it. And 2, as I was learning about property, I just found it so much more interesting than learning about shares. So in an essentialist sort of way, I, rather than trying to invest in every type of thing and spread myself thin, I sort of went, okay, I'm gonna go down the property tunnel. So that leads me into my second point, which is once you find your path, then you wanna think about your strategy. Property is incredibly, I think, overwhelming when you first get started in it. There are people who have strategies in terms of negative gearing. There are people who just want to purchase a house and pay it off immediately, which is to pay principal and interest. And then there are other people who will pay interest only and then basically hold on to a property and sell it at a higher price later on in life. And I won't go into the details about property in this video, but rather cover sort of the main overhead points of this entire journey. But if you want me to go into the details and the nitty gritty later on, just let me know in the comment section below. So I'd say that it took me a good 2 to 3 years of researching, understanding, learning more, whether that be reading books, whether that be watching YouTube videos. And eventually I found and came across a strategy from this guy who, and it really just resonated with me. I knew that as a business owner, and this is absolutely a personal choice of my own, that while I wanted to invest in property, I didn't have the traditional terms of security of that stable job. I always have this sense at the back of my mind, this understanding that my business could potentially just collapse one day for whatever reason whatsoever. And I want to be in a position where if that does happen, I'm okay here. So I knew for myself that negative gearing wasn't really attractive to me, but what was attractive was positive gearing, where basically the goal is to start making income from your property as soon as possible. As you start talking to people about property, you're going to find that people are incredibly opinionated, and a lot of people opinionated without really understanding what they're talking about as well. So take everyone's pieces of advice with a grain of salt. You know you best, you know your situation best, and I guess don't let too many people kind of sway you with whatever they think is right. They might have pursued the same property journey just like you, and they might have been successful in a particular way, but maybe that just doesn't resonate with you for a particular reason. And that's okay. You have to know you best, and you have to understand your goal and have extreme clarity behind that goal. And sometimes that does take a while. The third thing is savings. And I think with savings, this is something that hopefully you've even started doing before your property journey, but even if you start now, that's totally fine too. Like, I never feel like it's ever too late to start saving. I guess I don't have much to say here, except for the fact that it's important for you to save, obviously, because you're going to be putting down a big lump sum when it comes to purchasing your property. And there are a lot of fees that are involved with purchasing a property. So if you're looking at a property that's, say, $400,000, you generally have to pay a 20% deposit on that. And then you're gonna have to pay stamp duty, a lawyer, bank fees, a surveyor, a conveyancer, a building and pest inspector. And the main takeaway here is to start saving as soon as you get that inkling that you want to start investing. I think it's fine if you need to take time to research, but you want to hope that by the time you've done that research, you've actually saved enough for you to get out there and start doing your thing. The fourth thing is that you also need to understand that your finances need to look a certain way so that the banks will approve your loan. So for me, it was actually quite challenging because, one, I'm self-employed. So with what I was saying before, like, I'm not in a traditionally stable job. So even though I've been in my business for a few years now, it's still sort of that negative mark against my name because, I guess in their opinion, my income is deemed more risky. So that was a massive hurdle as well that I had to work with my accountant with. It basically meant that a lot of the traditional banks that you hear of weren't available for me, and that I had to seek out different types of banks, usually like tier 2 or tier 3 bank. Tier 1 banks are basically like your top 4 banks, the ones that you guys all know about. And then there are top tier 2 banks and then tier 3 banks. I think it just basically means that, like, there's more risk when it comes to going with more risk for you, actually, as somebody who goes with tier 2 and tier 3, in case, let's say, like, the bank collapses. But I think in Australia, that's sort of really unlikely. And I don't claim to know too much about it, but I was able to get my loan and I'm pretty happy with that. Just know that traditionally, when it comes to borrowing a loan, they take 2 years worth of your financial returns. So just bear that in mind, because you sort of want your numbers to look good in the previous 2 years in order for you to get that loan. And as I mentioned before, like, there are ways for you to go around this if that's not the case. But I guess what I'm trying to say here is that this property journey, it is a long sort of drawn out process, or at least it can be. The fifth thing is get yourself a good accountant and mortgage broker. For me, so an accountant is somebody who's gonna do all your numbers and make sure that you're prepped nice and clean for the banks for slaughter. Why did I say clean? I don't know. And the mortgage broker is somebody who helps to find the best loan for you. You have to remember though that with mortgage brokers, they will come with their own agenda as well, because they will get a commission basically if you are able to get a loan through them. So that commission is dependent on which bank you sign with. You know, some banks may pay them more than others. So I think just be aware that you shouldn't just completely trust one mortgage broker. I think it's good to shop around and find somebody who is a good fit for you. Having said that, sometimes you can find accountants who are also mortgage brokers, which is a really great double skill set to have, because then you can just go through them and they sort of understand everything from start to finish, from the loan perspective into the finance perspective, which is a powerful thing to have together. But also know that sometimes it just takes time to find the right person. I have been through 4 different accountants, and I have been through even more mortgage brokers before I found my one accountant and mortgage broker who I'm pretty happy with. The last thing I want to say here is just dive into it. At some point, you're going to realize that there's just so much information out there, and the more you learn, the less you know, which can be really frustrating. But it comes to a time where it's just kind of like, you know what, I've got as much information as I can have at this point in time. I could keep learning and I could keep procrastinating and keep learning more, but at that point in time, is that learning exponential anymore? Is it just sort of like learning bits and bits and you're sort of just really dragging it out? I think when you do such a big investment like this, of course there's always going to be doubt and uncertainty and fear. And I can tell you that when I purchased my second property, there was just so much confusion around that, and I really wasn't sure I'd made the right choice. I wasn't sure I'd made the right choice even when I was signing the loan documents. I wasn't sure I was making the right choice when I was signing the contract. But now, 4 months or so down the track, I feel pretty good about it, and I know that I made the right decision. At the time, like, I knew it was the right thing for me to do, but on the surface, and what made it difficult was those fears that I was trying to overcome. I think it's always better for you to sort of just dive into it and just do it. And yes, if you make a mistake and it's a big one, I think this is my philosophy, and you don't have to agree with this, but I think it's always better to have done a mistake and learn from it and then just move on, rather than wait to a time when you think you know everything, which could be, you know, 20 years the track, and you've just sort of like wasted those 20 years when you could have been building your pathway much sooner. Let me know if you're interested in property or if it's some sort of other investment that you're interested in. And make sure you subscribe and hit that notification button if you're interested in hearing more about my property journey, business journey, and self-improvement along the way. See you guys next time. Bye.